This episode of Because Science is sponsored by Star Wars Jedi Fallen Order.
Because no one's ever really gone, how might force lightning work? Let's get technical. Jedi and Sith are the superheroes of the Star Wars-iverse. They can sense the future, they can become ghosts apparently, and they can levitate things with their minds. Some can even summon what's called force lightning, which appears to be at least some kind of electrical discharge. But how might force lightning actually work? And how powerful would it have to be to fry us up some Jedi? Well, let's don our thinking robes and figure it out. Good. To understand what's going on, the robe was too hot. To understand what's really going on here, I believe we must consult the sacred texts of electrical engineering. Oh, jeez. Yoda hates books. Force lightning needs to move through the air, and so the study of electromagnetism tells us that a substance like air is traditionally a very good insulator in that it doesn't conduct electrical charges very well at all. However, even an insulating material like air has what's called a breakdown voltage. This is when you're running so much voltage through some material that it literally breaks down and becomes much more conductive if it was insulating before. Pretty much everything aside from like superconductors has a breakdown voltage, and we don't just have to talk about this in the abstract. You can experience breakdown voltage personally. Have you ever shuffled your feet across a carpet or something, unknowingly or not, and then touched something metal, like a doorknob, to get a pretty bad shock? Well, this is breakdown voltage at work. When you shuffle along a carpet, or you rub a balloon against your hair or what have you, you are literally transferring more negatively charged electrons onto the surface of your body, which creates an imbalance. When you then encounter something that's relatively speaking more positively charged, like that metal doorknob, this imbalance wants to equalize itself. And if the potential difference is great enough, a visible arc of electricity will break down the air in between you and a surface to equalize itself. And this can involve a lot more voltage than you may think. Don't be alarmed. Do not try to adjust your device. I know I'm out of focus and everything's dark, but it's because I want to show you breakdown voltage in air. For whatever reason, inside of the void, every few minutes, I build up a very large electrical charge on my body. So to demonstrate electrical breakdown in air for you, I'm going to wait a few minutes until I am charged, and then I'm gonna touch something metal like this pole here, and you will see just how much of an arc you can generate from a lot of voltage just moving around your everyday life. So, okay, just give me a second to get charged here. Because of breakdown voltage requirements, even something small like that packs a punch. That shock that I constantly get here in the void for some reason isn't very big, maybe like half a centimeter long, but the breakdown voltage for air is 3,000 volts per millimeter of air turning from insulator to conductor. This means that a decent static shock, like one you can see just touching a doorknob after shuffling around because you don't pick up your feet, why don't you listen to your mom, could be around 15 to 30,000 volts of electricity, which is in taser territory. Just think about that. Oh, man. Clearly, whatever voltages a Sith like Palpatine is generating must be a lot larger to arc all the way across the room, from a certain point of view. A certain point of view?
Yes.
I'm not a Force ghost anymore. To make Force lightning and to punish young Jedi for their lack of vision, a Sith like the Emperor would need to break down all the air between himself and his target and do so with enough voltage to initiate what's called an electron avalanche, which sounds even cooler than Force lightning. And it works like this. If there's a big enough potential difference inside of this electric field, an electron can be accelerated so much so that it smashes into another atom in the air and has enough energy to ionize that atom. In other words, rip its electrons from it. Those electrons are in turn accelerated in this electrical field, and they go on to smash into other atoms, creating a snowballing, avalanche-like effect of ionization. The larger the voltage, the bigger the avalanche, and the longer the arc. So what about the Emperor? Thankfully, for our purposes, we've already measured the breakdown voltage of normal Earth air at standard temperature and pressure. Assuming that air is similar in a galaxy far, far away, to arc across just 1 meter around 3 feet of space, the Emperor would need to generate around 3 million volts. Now we need to know just how far force lightning can travel. The first time we see the technique is when the Emperor decides to destroy Luke in the throne room. Now it's hard to measure this distance because of perspective, but it looks like the arc is maybe 2.5 Luke body lengths? Maybe? If that's the case, then unlimited power is around 15 million volts. But this isn't even the longest electrical arc that we see in Star Wars. No, that honor goes to Count Dooku in this scene in the prequels. Again, it's hard to measure because of perspective, but if you use Count Dooku's height and this breakdown value, you get around 22 million volts. And interestingly enough, both of these values are within the actual range for real lightning, which means that force lightning is as powerful as real lightning. It's not unlimited power, but it is certainly enough to fry up some Jedi. No, you can't fry a baby Yoda. So, if force lightning works by more or less creating short circuits between Sith and Jedi, this power must have something to do with moving electrons around at will. The Emperor or other force user then may operate like a humanoid Van der Graaff generator, able to use the force to create large electrical imbalances on their person that get so large they encourage a large breakdown of air in between them and their targets. At that point, the air in between them turns from insulator to conductor, and then the flow of electrons shocks a target into a state where they just need to ask their robo-daddy for help. Please. Remember that? I know this sounds weird, but the basic process happens with actual lightning during thunderstorms, as negative charges build up at the bottom of clouds and then equalize in the form of lightning strikes with the more positive ground beneath the clouds. And this would all mean, of course, that force users can manipulate electrons on an individual level. Which sounds fantastical, but if force users can also use their minds to lift many ton X-wings up out of puppet swamps, I don't think this is that much of a stretch. This might be how force lightning works, but we're not done yet, because if it does work this way, we have a very important announcement for anyone who is likely to challenge a Sith Lord.
A Sith Lord?
Yes. According to the laws of physics, anti-force lightning armor should be really easy to make. Please consider the following. If you are standing near a strong enough Tesla coil just a couple of feet away, you could be struck by millions of volts of electricity, and yet, a simple metal box can save you from having to call your robot papa for help. Why? Well, that's because a long, long time ago in a galaxy far, far away called Britain, a legendary scientist named Michael Faraday invented what I am now in, a Faraday cage. A Faraday cage looks like a simple metal mesh box, and that's because that's all it is. Faraday's insight, though, was that in the presence of an electric field with this orientation of metal, the electrons in that metal act in a certain way. Thanks to the shape of the box and the free electrons in the metal, in the presence of an external electric field, the electrons tend to bunch up on one side of the box, creating an opposing electrical field, and this results in no charge flowing on the inside of the box. And because of this, you can be insulated from Palpatine-like lightning. To make anti-force lightning armor, then, we would want some kind of garment that incorporates the idea of a Faraday cage into it. And guess what? We already have that. Our power line workers routinely service power lines that have hundreds of thousands of volts running through them, the kind of voltages that would fry them, and yet they are fine because they wear these Faraday suits, which have metal mesh woven into the garment, and they operate like a Faraday cage operates. And so, with our knowledge of this kind of fabric and of equalizing electric fields, we can make a bold recommendation to the Jedi Council. Honored members of the Jedi Council, anyone who is to face off against a Sith Lord should be wearing robes lined with Faraday mesh. It would protect your people from Palpatine-like lightning, and it should be easy enough to just weave some space metal into your clothing there. My galaxy already has the technology to do this, and it would make sense, even if it's not in the sacred text. So, do you grant me the rank of master? No. It's not fair! I'm gonna grow my hair out and get a scar on my face and live in a volcano planet! So, how does force lightning work? Well, if force users could manipulate the universe down to the level of individual electrons, they might be able to encourage those electrons to form giant imbalances on bodies, break down the air, and form large arcs of electricity between themselves and their targets. And it wouldn't even require unlimited power, just a few million volts. And that should be more than doable for a Senate seat-throwing, monster-face-having evil space ghost, right? Because science. Well, not the ghost part. The electron part. Star Wars is weird. And not the other you get it. Thanks again to Star Wars Jedi Fallen Order for sponsoring today's episode. You play Cal Kestis, a young Jedi Padawan who narrowly escaped the purge of Order 66 following the events of Episode 3, Revenge of the Sith. On a quest to rebuild the Jedi Order, you must pick up the pieces of your shattered past to complete your training, develop powerful new force abilities, and master the art of the iconic lightsaber, all while staying one step ahead of the Empire and its deadly Inquisitors. Star Wars Jedi Fallen Order is available now on Xbox One, PS4, and PC.